streams louder.
Hello everyone, this is Biology Insights and welcome back to another video lecture of the series Inheritance Biology. When we talk about inheritance, we got to be reminded Mendel, who started the genetical experiments back then. Mendel was lucky enough to get pretty simple expression of genes. One was dominant and another was recessive. Easy, right? As science expanded, we got to know that genes are not that easy. We found some scenarios beyond Mendelism, and we call it as extension of Mendelism. From various extensions, we have gone through some, and still left with some. To get the next scenario of extension, let us look at an experiment done by Lucien Cunot in 1905. He observed two different coat colors in mice. One was brown and one was yellow. Let's consider A is the allele for brown color, and AY is the mutated allele that gives yellow color. After mating two yellow mice, he observed that the offspring never showed the normal 3-to-1 phenotypic ratio. Instead, he always observed 2-to-1 ratio, with two yellow mice for every one brown mouse. Thus, he determined that yellow coat color was dominant phenotypic trait, and by using test crosses, he showed that all yellow mice were heterozygous. However, from many and many crosses, he never produced a single homozygous yellow mouse. How could this be? The explanation of such results is that an individual with both the dominant alleles dies during early embryonic development. This kind of allele is called recessive lethal allele. In this case, allele AY is dominant for yellow coat color, but it is recessive lethal with respect to viability. Not every lethal allele leads to immediate death. It may even take years to show its lethality too. For example, in human diseases like brachydactyly, sickle cell anemia, Tay Sachs disease, and phenylketonuria, the homozygous born, but the life expectancy is way shorter. While in Huntington's disease, the homozygous gets affected after the age of 40. Well, sometimes lethal alleles become killers during certain environmental conditions, and these alleles are called conditional lethal alleles. For example, some of it cause an organism to die only in a particular temperature range and act as temperature-sensitive lethal alleles. Many organisms, including Drosophila, has TS lethal allele that develops larva at high temperature, but the larva survives only if grown at lower temperature. Temperature-sensitive lethal alleles are typically caused by mutations that alter the structure of encoded protein, so it does not function correctly at the non-permissive temperature or becomes unfolded and is rapidly degraded. So do you think lethal alleles are killer all the time? Well, not really. Sometimes they spare lives of some people from the population. Yeah, you're still villain enough. This kind of lethal allele, which kills only some individuals of the population and not all, is called semi-lethal. Have you heard about hemophilia? That's right, an X-linked genetic disorder which causes deficiency of blood clotting factors. So, if a hemophiliac has an injury by broken plate, the blood is not gonna clot and an urgent attention is needed, or else the person would die due to loss of blood. The responsible mutated allele in this case is semi-lethal, because every hemophiliac is not gonna die if they get proper attention. A bit scary, right? So do you know someone fighting from any of these? Tell them that they are bravest in all. Here we are done with one more extension state, but we are still left with some. And to get each of them, join the channel and hit the bell icon so you will be notified whenever they are introduced to you. If you enjoyed it, give us a thumbs up and share this to your study partner. See you in the next lecture.